that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
That we may continually be given to good works through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. When the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, the people gathered around Aaron and said to him, "Come, make gods for us who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we don't know what has become of him." Aaron said to them, "Take off the gold rings that are on the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people took off all the gold rings from their ears and brought them to Aaron. He took the gold from them, formed it into a mold, and cast an image of a calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, "Tomorrow shall be a festival to the Lord." They rose early the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought sacrifices of well-being, and the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to revel. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely, and they have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now, let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people. The word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 106. You'll find it in your bulletin, and we will read it together responsively by whole verse. Hallelujah. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever.
Who can declare the mighty acts of the Lord, or show forth all his praise?
Happy are those who act with justice and always do what is right.
Remember me, O Lord, for the favor you have for your people, and visit me with your saving help.
That I may see the prosperity of your elect and be glad with the gladness of your people, that I may glory with your inheritance.
We have sinned as our forebears did. We have done wrong and dealt wickedly.
Israel made a bull calf at Oreb and worshipped a molten image.
And so they exchanged their glory for the image of an ox that feeds on grass.
They forgot God, their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt.
Wonderful deeds in the land of Ham, and fearful things at the Red Sea.
So he would have destroyed them had not Moses, his chosen, stood before him in the breach to turn away his wrath from consuming.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. My brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I also ask you, my loyal companion, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel. Together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
banquet. But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, "The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet." Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, "Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I cannot count the number of times that I have had some variation of the dream. The procession has started, and I'm not vested yet. I run to the vesting room, only unable to find my alb and my cincture. Of course, I could grab one from the hundreds of albs in the vesting room, but they're either too long or too short. If I somehow manage to run into church vested, usually the service has begun without me. Thank you very much, Stephen. And sure enough, when I look at the pulpit, my sermon is nowhere to be found. Now, before I was a priest, the nightmares were about a test for a class that I haven't attended all semester, or a classroom I can't find, or a mystery locker that has all my needed books. We all have them, or at least I hope I'm not the only one who has them. I've heard of church musician nightmares about unpracticed pieces of music or music missing from the music stand. And of course, there's the classic nightmare of showing up to an important event without your clothes. So, in our gospel lesson, when the person who was not originally invited to the wedding banquet because he didn't have enough social capital to be put on the spot in front of everyone by an agitated and somewhat violent host about not wearing the right garment, our anxiety level and sense of injustice soars. What if he didn't own a wedding garment? Maybe he was too poor to have one. Maybe he didn't know the social mores of fancy banquets. Surely God does not cast us out with no regard for human dignity. Isn't that what Jesus was all about? Loving and welcoming all? Now, truth be told, this whole parable is one of those awful parables we wish we could skip or at least skim until we reach something a little more palatable. With the Holy Land crumbling into violence and suffering, the last thing I wanted to read this week was of entitled invitees to a king's wedding feast, violently mistreating messengers from the king, and retaliatory destruction and burning of cities. And then, when the seemingly guilty parties have done to them what was done to others, the king cannot seem to contain his anger, and he lashes out at a seemingly innocent man about not wearing the right garment, even though he had very little time to prepare for the afterthought invitation to a banquet. And what has been a week of violence particularly violence against civilians on both sides. The last thing I wanted this morning was more violence from our gospel lesson. If we are going to tackle, though, this parable, we really are going to have to step back and take a look at what's happening. First, as one scholar explains, this parable is not intended for literal interpretation. For example, the king is like God in some sense, but he is not the same as God. Likewise, this son for whom the banquet is being thrown is not Jesus. His slaves who are sent out to call the invited guests are not prophets, and the invited guests are not Israel. The king's violent response is not the same as the fall of Jerusalem. Allegorical interpretation is not wrong with parables, but it does have limitations. Indeed, the allegorical interpretation cannot explain the complexities of this parable of the wedding banquet. Now, second, despite our inability or our ability to remove then those immediate comparisons of God with this violent king, Matthew does say at the beginning that the kingdom of God is like this parable. So there is some learning, even in the uncomfortable casting out of the man who shows up to the party with the wrong garb, fulfilling every anxiety dream we have ever had. When we hear those harsh words, "Many are called, but few are chosen," we finally understand the so what of all this violence and seeming overreactions. Scholar Caroline Lewis explains, "Many are called, but few are chosen indeed. The chosen are the ones who realize that just showing up is not enough anymore. The chosen are the ones who insist that mere acquiescence, week after week, day after day, to doctrine and dogma will not stand the test of what it means to be salt of the earth and light of the world. The chosen are the ones who believe that a God who is Emmanuel might very well have a claim on their humanity. And the chosen are the ones who understand that the time for bringing about the kingdom of heaven is now. Not later, not tomorrow, not someday, but now." Today's language is violent and somewhat despondent. And although they may not literally be applied to God, this text does come with consequences. Today's text reminds us that RSVPing to church and showing up to consume comfort and reassurance is not the totality of membership in the body of Christ. Showing up in this community means being gifted with the clothing of discipleship, clothing that we put on every single week. We are always welcome in these chairs and online. And to belong here means to take on the clothing of discipleship. As Lewis says, we can no longer don the clothing of complacency, conformity, and any kind of garb that is content with the way things are. Today, we are invited to put on the kind of compassion birthed by God's own righteousness that cannot anymore leave things the way they are. But no need to worry about a new anxiety dream. If you forget your clothing of discipleship, we have that clothing ready for you every Sunday. That is why in stewardship season, so many of us are generous with our gifts of time and talent and treasure, because we know how precious that weekly garb is. We know the feeling of coming to church weary or downtrodden or just tired. And We also know the feeling of leaving church empowered and invigorated to slip on that gown of discipleship anew for the coming week. Hickory Neck is the place we come to every week to join in the communal feast. And Hickory Neck is the place where that weekly feast emboldens us to feed others. There is no casting out into the outer darkness from these doors, not without the garb of discipleship that we are gifted with from this place of nourishment and of belonging. Amen.
Almighty God, you assure us that when two or three are gathered in your name, you will be in the midst of us. We offer before you our prayers, that in doing so, we may be drawn ever nearer to you. As you have knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship, make us children of God and heirs of eternal life. We pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Susan, our bishop, and Jennifer, Charles, Jim, and Bob, our clergy. God of love and mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Christ, you gather all nations before you and offer blessings to those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. We pray for President Biden, Governor Youngkin, and the legislature and judiciary, this community, the nation, and the world. God of love and mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, you teach us to love our neighbor as ourselves. Direct and rule our hearts to see the neighbor in all those we meet, near and far, so we might better see you. We pray for those in need around the world and close to home, especially for the ministry of From His Hands. God of love and mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, we seek out your sheep and offers who seeks out your sheep and offers blessings to those who mourn and are poor in spirit. Have mercy on all those in any need or suffering, especially Heather, Frank, Lisa, Mike, Jean, Craig, Cindy, Sue, Scott, George, Cheryl, Dale, Shirley, Grayson, Chris, Brandon, Pete, Esther, Ray, Ann, Curtis, Buddy, Ellen, Margene, Cindy, Dawn, April, Jenny, Jennifer, Lucy, Penny, and those being impacted by violence in the Holy Land. For the men and women serving in the armed forces, especially Zachary, Jenny, Tim, Max, Owen, and Billy. God of love and mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Loving God, grant to the faithful departed a share in the inheritance of the saints, and bring us at last to the same blessedness. God of love and mercy,
hear our prayer.
Especially for Bill Harrison, Cindy Heilman, and Layla Farron. We pray also for the forgiveness of our sins.
Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sins. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. All your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We have a ministry moment today, so I'm going to invite Cindy to come up and join us here at the pulpit.
Good morning.
My name is Cindy Steinhauser,
and I was the former chair for the Community Engagement Council. Marina Libro now leads that, but I wanted to share with you some of what has gone on with the Community Engagement Council this past year. Not long after Skip and I came to Hickory Neck, Bob Gay, good morning Bob, our deacon contacted us and with his vision on a new approach for outreach and having the community come into our parish. He wanted to make sure that our parishioners had the word that you bring to us, your discernments and what you want to see happen in our community and in our parish. So we, along with several other members, Bob Pringle, Bill Teal, Terry Linsmeyer, and Pete Haynes, were given a book to read. It was called Canoeing the Mountains. Think about canoeing the mountains. So in this story, this was about Lewis and Clark and their journey to find the Pacific Ocean. Now, like Lewis and Clark, part of the journey, they knew what to do. They had the tools to do them. However, when they reached the mountains, they had no idea how they were going to go over those mountains to reach the Pacific Ocean. And so too, our council, we knew and we had a lot that we could do, but we also knew that we were at a point that we needed to do more. So like that, we had some journey issues, and of course we had them when we had the pandemic, which was particularly challenging. But through the generous donations of this parish, we have been able to make donations to local nonprofits like the Grove Food Pantry, Avalon, Williamsburg Faith in Action, the Salvation Army, and Greater Williamsburg Outreach Ministry. Our participation has been continued with the backpacks for Avalon and for Burnt Ordinary, the Silver Bells and Angel Tree. Meals were and are provided from His hands, which we prayed for today, and the delivery to our homeless who live in hotels. Most recently, we partnered with St. Martin's and with Bruton Parish to build and deliver 39 beds from Heavenly Peace. We have planned to do that again in the spring, so be aware. With the cooler weather approaching, the one thing that we want to say is that Hickory Neck, again, is going to be a site for a homeless shelter. So while I'll try not to badger anybody or stalk anybody, I will be coming forward to ask for good volunteers. For our families with young children, it's an opportunity, while you may not be on site, to help with the lunch making for the bag lunches that have to be done daily for the week that we're going to do this. It's going to be February 25th through March the 3rd. Previously, we also provided shelter to the homeless in 22. And partnered in 23 with James River Baptist. The goals of the CEC are to encourage and support and assist our Hickory Neck parishioners to employ their best interests, skills, and address the needs of the community and beyond. The support can be in the form of education, resources, and tools to advance and sustain the parishioners' ministries. We need your ideas and your passions to grow Hickory Neck and assist our community. The baptized, young and old, ordained and lay are all partners in the gospel work. But you won't be an Allen. The CEC will be here to help you attain your purposes. Still, with the waning of COVID that we know will always be with us, a need for activities to provide funds to benefit our community is needed. We're so grateful to the successful and delightful murder mystery for the generous contributions of talent, time, and monetary funds for the community needs. Special thanks to Paula Simmons, who's spearheading Amazing Grace again this year. And as Alan said so eloquently a few weeks back regarding the children's ministry, we need your help. Luke 10:2 reads, he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." May the Holy Spirit move us to share the knowledge, skill, and financial resources that God has entrusted us with. Thank you.
We have entered into stewardship season. You should have received your packet of information that has our mission plan, our narrative budget, as well as a pledge card, a time and talent form, and some other things for you in there. So today, our leaders, our vestry members, and our stewardship committee members are asking to serve as leaders, as models for how we contribute to Hickory Neck. So I'm inviting them forward at this time to process their pledges, and we'll be saying a prayer over those. Our call to be servant leaders. As we seek to follow your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and give our whole lives to your service, let these portions of who we are and what we have help us along the way. We know you have blessed us with abundance, and while we often do not see it, help us to know you better through generosity to your church, to each other, and to the world around us. To you, all hearts are open. Bless these gifts that they may transform others through your church, and bless them so that they may transform our lives as part of our journey to you and with you. We ask this in the name of the Holy Trinity, one God. Amen. Amen. As you may know, you've got time, so certainly if you have your pledge card this week or in the weeks to come, you're welcome to put that in the offering plate at any time. We will also have an official big gathering of all those pledges on November 12th for our celebration Sunday. If you've already pledged, you will get a card, actually like I turned in today, that just says, I have pledged. So you'll be able to be a part of that liturgy in a festive way. And there will be a festive brunch afterwards. So I hope you will plan to be with us on that day. Before then, there are some exciting things going on. Wanted you to know that tonight we have a musical offering that we are very excited about. At 5 o'clock, Thomas Kiesecker will be coming to us. He is a composer and musician and performer, and will be offering a beautiful selection of music. So I hope you will come and join us and celebrate in the gift of music this evening. You also have seen in your epistle that Amazing Grayson has opened up. The shop is online, and so you can go do your shopping. I am told that more and more donations are coming in, so you may want to shop often because your favorite item may have appeared. Know that all the commitments go towards supporting the work of community engagement and our community. Also hold on your calendar November the 1st, which is our first All Saints Evensong, something we haven't offered before, but we're really excited about. There'll be a dinner at 5, and the Evensong is at 6, and we hope that you will join us for that. I think those are all the big things. Did I miss anything? Yes. I did. Oh, yes, sorry. For that concert, some things have to shift around. So if you are able before you, or maybe after you get your coffee, but before you head out, if you would grab something at Stephen's direction, that will help us a lot. That'll help us clear the space that we've got room for it. Thank you for that reminder. What else? We have another one? Yes. If you come right in the middle and talk loud, you'll be fine.
Just a reminder, this Saturday is men's breakfast. We'll be gathering around 8:15. The meal will be served around 8:30. You're all welcome to come. I do send out emails if I have an email address. If I don't, if you'll please forward it to me, I'd love to include you. It's a good fellowship morning with the men of the church. Nothing political. Stay out of controversy. Just have a good time. Hope you can come.
On November the 19th, we had the recertification of the automatic defibrillators. We were way overdue, pandemic. We haven't done it in 4 years. The class can be no bigger than 25, and we have 23 now, so we need 3 more. On the kiosk, if you sign up or see me, it'll be at 11:30 on the 19th of November. It takes about an hour and a half. So we'd like to get 3 more members to do that.
We get it all? All right. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. Pray you, gracious God, descend your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.